curse of fear. I will call it the curse of fear. Amen. Fear is a powerful, powerful weapon that Satan has used very well, especially against the black race. Fear has been sown into us psychologically. Fear has been propagated as a control mechanism. You must understand fear. Fear is an invisible prison. Fear automatically sets limitation. All Satan has to do is to bring up an image of what may happen bad, and that's enough to stop most people from going forward. Fear is a great weapon. Most of my life I spent in fear, not understanding that it was bred into me. I was raised in fear. We were afraid of everything. We were taught to be afraid of everything. We were so afraid of everything that we live and die within 10 blocks. Some of us are so afraid we have never been to Indiana, which is right there. We were afraid of the water, afraid of the air, afraid to fly, afraid to go in the car too far, afraid to go out of town. We're afraid of everything. We're even afraid of success, which is one of the worst fears. You know why we hate on each other so much? We're scared of success. We are fearful of success. You'd be surprised how many people are scared of money. They scared of money, scared of, soon, that's why as soon as you get some, somebody mad at you. You're not holy, you're not spiritual. Because this fear has been bred into us as a control mechanism. Have you ever wondered why there was more slaves than there were masters? But yet the slaves did not revolt and run. There was some slave revolts, but there was like over a million slaves. And they had way more numbers of slaves than they had masters, but yet they would not revolt. Because the master understood that I don't have to physically chain them if I can psychologically chain them with fear. So I can show them freedom with no fence. There'll be no fence. But they won't run because the chain is no longer upon their legs or their hands. The chain is in the mind. Fear is a prison of the mind. Come on, talk back to them. That's a good word. Fear is a prison of the mind. Fear works on maybe, might be, coulda, it might happen. Fear is a mental image, an imagination. To show you a picture of an impending doom that causes you to back up. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So I don't have to physically fight you to stop you. All I have to do is scare you and I can stop you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It's so ingrained in our culture. There was something I saw growing up. There was a brother that was very good at football. He played football his whole life. Ever since we went to school, from middle school up to high school, he was a football player, one of the best. Everybody knew this boy would go to college, get a scholarship, and go to college. Now, because we were not in the sports, y'all know we was in the streets doing what we were doing wrong, but we was encouraging him. You know how you do, you encourage him, even though you're not doing it, but you still wanna see somebody make it. So we said, he'll make it. The boy got accepted to college, and right when he was about ready to go, his mother got afraid of him leaving here and told him, I don't want you to go. So he didn't go to college out of fear and ended up selling drugs with us, getting locked up. This is what fear did. Instead of releasing him into his destiny whereby his man skills have to come out of him. Oh, y'all ain't ready, y'all. She cut his leg off out of fear. This is what Willie Lynch taught us. To cripple our sons so they cannot function but be led but not lead. They'll be strong in the body but weak in the mind. All that is done through fear. I'm fearful he might get killed, so I'm going to hold him instead of letting him grow up. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Fear is a great, great motivator. Most of what you have done has been out of fear. Most of your decisions have been based upon fear. This is one of the greatest weapons that I have fought in my life. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? So I want to talk to you today about this curse of fear. We all have it. It's not a racial thing. Actually, everybody has fear. Blacks have fear. Chinese have fear. Whites have fear. Whites have fear. Blacks. Blacks have fear. Whites. Everybody got fear. We all scared of everything. This country teaches us fear. That's what CNN and Fox News is designed to do. Scare you to death. Have you scared to come outside, scared to trust, scared to love, stay on social media in a fake land. Talking about you got 500 friends and none of them you don't know. You know why social media is so big? Because it's you don't have to risk anything. There's no fear in it. That's why people get on social media and get gassed out. Chest gets big, start talking crazy. They don't say stuff on social media they would never say to your face. They get very bold because there's no fear there. So people love social media. That's why it's so big. People rather live in that la-la land of social media than actually talk to people. Because true relationships is a risk. It costs me something to enter into a relationship with you. I have to trust me. I have to trust you. Social media, I can just check out what you said on your page, leave you a note for the day, and we cool. That's not friendship. I haven't risked anything. You know why people are so busy, ready to murder each other? Because there's no true relationship. It's all in cyberspace. It's not real. We texting each other. Can't even pick up the phone and call. I had somebody do that to me recently. Gonna text me for some business. You want something from me, but you can't even call me. This is how bad it's getting because it is easier to disassociate ourselves through technology than to actually speak to a person straight up because I have to risk something to talk to you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? All our lives we have seen, we have been motivated by being afraid. Your relationships are based upon fear. How you treat your children is based upon fear. Who you love is based upon fear. How you look is based upon fear of what people will say about you. We live our life in a prison called fear. One of the most liberating things is to be delivered from fear. It's to not be afraid of what anyone really thinks about you, to have enough confidence that when you leave a room, I don't care what y'all thought. I don't worry about how people see me. It's very liberating for that to happen. And that's what I'm going to teach you today. Are you there? Now look at Numbers chapter 13. Let me show you something. Say break fear. And it really does have to be broken. That means go against it. Go against your tendency to be afraid. Because as the one thing Jesus said about the last days is fear not, fear not, fear not. And everything is designed to make you afraid. Everything is causing us to be so afraid. If you don't believe me, go to the gun store. See how afraid people are. See how many guns people buying. They got 100 guns. Can't shoot but one, but they got 100 because they scared. They got 100 of them. I've seen it. People are afraid of everything. And as we, now the problem with fear is fear, the response of fear, are y'all ready? The response of fear is anger. People, when they find themselves afraid, the number one thing, what happens first is they get angry at what made them fearful. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So fear manifests itself in outward anger towards others. So racist people are not really angry. They're really fearful. But the fear manifests itself outwardly as anger. Let's say a relationship. I'm not really angry at you. I'm fearful of you because you have an ability to hurt me. And because I know you can hurt me, I'm fearful that I'm vulnerable to you. Now that vulnerability makes me angry that I'm out of, because the reason why I'm really angry is I can't control. So my anger is My anger is a mechanism to control you. That's why I'm displaying anger, because I want to control you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because control is the safest place. If I'm in control, I don't have to be afraid, because I'm in control. This is why people manipulate, intimidate people in relationships, because they want to be on top. Everybody's striving to be on top because we're fearful of each other. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Very seldom do you find people that will let you be you. Most people will mold you to what makes them not afraid of you. Most people will hate in you what makes them afraid. And they will set out to mold you out of that, to get that out of you, to fight you in that area, because that area of you makes them afraid. And instead of them adjusting themselves, saying, I don't want got the issue, they're going to change everybody around them to fit their fear. This is what control is. In Christ, he liberates us from fear, and we can let you be you, because my trust is no longer in people. My trust is in him. Meaning that any relationship he brings into my life, because he led him into my life, that whether it's going to be good or bad, I trust that I'm going to get the maximum out of this relationship. Whether they're good or bad. See, even bad relationships, I can get some benefit from. Therefore, when I know that my times and seasons are really in his hands, I'm not afraid of what comes in my life. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Because my trust is in him. Say, my trust. My trust is in him. That's how I learned to love my wife. I didn't love my wife because she was a good woman. I learned to love my wife by trusting God. Because the way I was raised on meet somebody, immediately get to the top of the relationship, get on top of them. Stand on top of them so you can control them, and you will never have to worry about them hurting you. That's what I learned. When I got married, I understood I can't live that way. And so I began to learn to trust God. And I began to say, I thought I loved her, but I really didn't love her. I was afraid of her. So what I was doing was I was treating her harshly. Or I was angry at her most of the time because I was scared to trust her. Y'all want this? Yeah, I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to give you something, some meatloaf to stick right here in your rib bone to help you. So I was afraid. So what I would do was my fear would come out in anger. And what would happen was, and so what began to happen was, I began to realize that it wasn't necessarily that she had the responsibility of making me secure. See, this is what's wrong with some of y'all. How's somebody going to make you feel secure? Girl, you insecure because you insecure. Somebody going to make me feel good about myself. That's yourself. Nobody make me feel, I feel good about me. Nobody completes you. That's Hollywood. Nobody completes. Everybody's undone. And when you meet a person, you're going to meet an undone person. They're going to have flaws and their own stuff to work on. And if we work on ourselves, we ain't got time for each to work on each other. We won't be arguing with each other because I'm too busy working on myself. So what I found was, my anger would manifest, my fear would manifest in anger, and the anger pushed her away, and that was a safe place for me. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? When the Lord began to deal with me about that, he began to tell me, you don't trust her because you don't trust me. That's why you got to have a relationship with God. You don't trust her because you don't trust me. Because if you trusted me, you would trust that I brought her. And if I brought her, then I knew what you needed. And the good and the bad is a part of my plan for you. So my trust was not with her. it was with him. All of your real issues are with God. Now, Satan is crafty to make you focus on people, but it's really your problem is always going to be with God. He is the ultimate. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Now, let me read this scripture. Are y'all getting anything out of what I'm trying to tell you? Now, Numbers chapter 13. Are you there? Look at verse 31. Verse 31. But when the men that went up, this is when they was going into the promised land, they sent down spies to spy out the land. But the men that went with him said, we will not be able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. And they brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, so we were in their sight. Now, these people, these spies went to spy out the land before the children of Israel were to cross over into the land. And they came back with this report and said, look, we done saw these people in the land. These people are giants. They eat people. And we are just like little grasshoppers in their sight. Now, what I want you to get the image of is because they were afraid, they drew a picture. They drew a mental picture. They said, we are this, based upon their fear. Y'all got what I'm saying? They reduced themselves. In other words, fear will make something seem bigger than what it is. We saw ourselves as grasshoppers. Now what I always want to ask them is, who told you that you was the grasshopper? Who told you? Where did you get that image from? Because the Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So Satan's job is to get the wrong image in your heart, and that's how you'll begin to think. That's why I don't meditate on things that cause me to think wrong. I don't sit up watching horror movies. I don't sit up looking at stuff that's going to make me afraid. Don't be talking about I want to get over fear and you watching Saw and The Walking Dead and you will CSI all this murder stuff and you want to know why you running through the house scared with the lights off, jumping in the bed with your feet up. You want to, because you watching it. I don't meditate on fear. One thing that I did with my children, and my wife can attest to this, we never let them watch nothing scary growing up. We never let them watch scary stuff. We never, because I said they're not going to get that, because that's where fear came in us. You know, our people was kind of slow. When you sinful, you don't know the impact of sin. So you just let your children sit there and watch stuff. You watch and you think, you don't even realize our child cannot process this murder and killing and Jason. That's what they let us watch, Jason. Here you are, 5-year-old watching Jason. Now, then an adult know this is a movie, but you are a child. You still think Bugs Bunny halfway real. You don't even know you think the Easter Bunny real. You think you can't process this stuff. But they sit there and let you watch Michael Myers and Jason, The Exorcist. And they wonder where the fear come from. So we never let them watch that because I said, I don't want them to be afraid. Matter of fact, just to show you something, my youngest daughter, Hannah, we had sent her down recently to spend some time with Stacia in Costa Rica, and then was on her way back. She had to come back by herself, and then she's just 15, but she had to come back by herself. And she had to go through two airports and two planes, and the plane in Miami from Costa Rica was delayed, and it was a storm, and so she had to stay overnight in the airport by herself, and then she had the plane coming out of Miami, she had to go to Philadelphia, and then that plane was delayed, so she had to stay in Philadelphia all night again by herself. She had to go leave the airport by herself, go to the hotel. All this was by herself. She's internationally traveling by herself. But she's on the phone, no fear. She's doing stuff that my wife didn't even tell her. She doesn't know what to do. Not afraid, not scared. Why? Because we never sold fear. We never just, oh, we don't do that. She had enough confidence to know what to do. Because fear did not limit her. Fear did not grip her. This is what happens when you don't sow fear into your children. They're not limited. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I thought that was awesome. I wouldn't have been able to do that at 15. I wouldn't have been able to know how to get on planes, passports, and go through airports and do all that stuff and miss flights and still be able to navigate. I wouldn't have been able to do that. But we never allow fear to be a part of their vocabulary. We always encourage them that you can do something. And not only did we, you cannot just tell your child what they can do and don't invest in them. You have to invest in them. You can't let the school invest or daycare or somebody else invest. You have to be the greatest investor. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Now, so this fear that this image that these guys drew was a mental picture that caused the whole camp to become frozen. Because this is really what fear is designed to do. It freezes you. It literally, it's the only thing I've seen that will stop you in your tracks, fear. There's nothing physical, but you feel it physically. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I don't have to do nothing to you. All I got to do is make you afraid, and your fear will stop you. And so this is the reason why the Bible says, listen, faith comes by hearing. Come on, comes by hearing. That means faith is a belief system. Faith is neutral. It's neither positive nor negative. Faith just means a belief system. A belief system is built upon what you meditate upon. Y'all got what I'm saying? A belief system is built upon what you think about all the time. I'm going to say it again. Faith is neutral. You know what neutral is. You put the car in neutral and it don't go nowhere. That means faith is middle. It's neutral. Faith is swayed based upon what you think about all the time. That's what builds your belief system. If you hang with murderers, you will have faith or a belief system that murder's okay. If you hang with drug dealers, you will adopt that belief system that drug dealing is okay. Faith is neutral. It's just what you surround yourself with and what you meditate upon. So the Bible says faith comes by hearing. It means what I hear is what builds my belief system. Come on, I'm going to teach y'all this. What I hear is what builds my belief system. So if I meditate on, give me a song, something I can meditate on. I don't even know this music y'all got nowadays. I'm older. I'm happy to be older. I'm glad I'm older. But if you meditate on turn up constantly, then that's what your belief system going to be. See, whatever you meditate, whatever you listen to the most. See, you cannot, the Bible says you cannot, bitter water and sweet water does not come out of the same fountain. You cannot get good out of bad. This is our real problem. Let me just go on. I'm going to go on here. This is really what our real problem is. We think we can sow bad and get good. We trying to sow apples and want oranges. The Bible says, whatever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Whatever you put out there is what you're going to get back. And I ain't talking about karma. I'm talking about a spiritual principle put in the earth that what you sow, you will reap it. You cannot call, you cannot, like, okay. I want a good man. No, I'm going to help you. I'm good. We're all the real men. I want a real man. You got fake hair, fake eyes, a girdle on holding your fake stomach. You got fake nails. Your credit is fake. You live on Section 8. That's fake. But yet you want a. Now, how in the world are you sowing fake? And think you gon' no, ain't no won't real. Think you gon' get real. You gon' get what you sow. You gon' get a fake Negro with a fake job with a fake rapper that smoke fake weed called spice. He ain't even smoke real weed. Living a fake life with fake chains. You cannot get good from bad. What a man soweth, that shall he reap. This is our major problem. I see it all the time. Y'all ready for me? Where's God at? I just want God to just do this, and I just need God to show up and to help me and just be right there when I call him, right? You go to church, you go to the club. You receive the word, you receive the word, you receive pornography. Y'all want to talk. Somebody want to talk. You say you love them, you cuss them out. Do you understand how you're getting what you're sowing? Y'all don't want this. I'm giving it to you today. I wasn't going to go here, but I'm here. Go over here. I'm here now. I'm here. This is y'all know I'm a realist and I try to help them. I don't want to be playing no game. You're going to get what you sow. Did you know most of what y'all problem is that you reaping what you sow? Now, ain't nobody hating on you. This is what you've done. If you treat people bad, ain't nobody hating when they say something back to you. Some hatred is just a good commentary. It's not hatred, it's a commentary. That means I'm looking at something and I'm saying what I see. You know how you watching a football game? Oh, yeah, he had a good run right there. Oh, he messed up. That's what I'm doing. It's not hating because I'm telling you what I see. You reap what you sow. Are y'all there? This nation is in the process of reaping. America's reaping. That's why I'm don't care. Let it burn. I ain't no crime stopper trying to stop her. Let's all come now. I ain't come together with nobody. Come together with my wife and Christ. I ain't come together with nobody else. Ain't no saving, no. Let's jump. You know how you seen them movie? They jumping in front of them. I ain't jumping in front of no bullets. I ain't going to lay my life down. I ain't getting shot, stuck, stabbed. None of that for none of y'all. Ain't it funny how people do dirt. They want you to come and sacrifice your life. The devil is a lie. Devil is a lie. I ain't fighting your wars. I ain't fighting doing none of that. Call me. I'm not patriotic. No, I ain't putting my hand on my heart either now. I ain't going to get mad at the girl not putting the hand on. Did you see the stuff that they come up with? Don't put that. You ain't patriotic. No, we not patriotic. This country is not supportive of us. What do you mean patriotic? I ain't singing no anthems or nothing. This reaping, it's reaping what is sowed. And the problem is the systems that have kept America afloat is broken and they're not going to be fixed. And God's doing it. Let me help y'all. Let me bless y'all. So some of y'all who just don't see for looking at the trees. God created Hillary and Donald Trump. It's both of them. Both of these people are going to be the judgment. It don't matter who it is. God, he gave you no choice. You're going to be judged. Donald going to judge you or Hillary going to judge you, but judgment's coming. These people are judgment. Whenever God judges a nation, he gets the worst of the nation and make the worst your leader. See, the nation's under judgment, so see, when God wants to judge a people, he go get people like you. He goes among the people, because it wouldn't be fair for God to judge you and the person that he put over you wasn't like you. He gets somebody like you, put them over you, and then they become your judgment. You remember when God told, when children of Israel said, oh, God, give us a king. And God said, listen, now look, let me be your king. And you said, oh, now we want to be like them. Okay, he said, well, I'm going to give you a king, but this is what he's going to do. He's going to bring your sons into slavery, take your lands, and he's going to do, this how he's going to treat you. And they said, we don't care, we still want it. He went amongst them and got Saul. Saul was their worst king. And when he brought Saul, Saul was one of the worst kings that Israel had, but they asked for that. So whenever God wants to judge a people, he just gets the worst. So why y'all sitting here, friend, Hillary, now this is just smoke and mirrors for you. to make you think your vote count. Hillary was already chosen by the Illuminati. She's going to be the president. She's going to be, unless she died, which I don't think that's going to happen. So she's chosen to be the president. So I don't know why y'all even going with this stuff. This fake racial stuff they doing, it's really fake. Now, the feelings of people are not fake. Just because they setting up fake scenarios to make you racist, those racist feelings are real. But the scenarios are false. Because the reason why I like Donald Trump, now understand when I say I like them, I'm not vote. I don't mean liking that way. I like them because Donald Trump revealed what we've been saying the whole time. Racism never came out till Donald Trump came out. Then all of a sudden everybody came out. Now we've been sitting there saying the whole time there's an undertone of racism. No, we post-racial, ain't no racism in America. No, that's just in y'all mind. But Donald Trump brought everybody racism out. I said, that's what I want to see. Thank you, Trump. The Hillary Clinton over at Nay-Nay, and then y'all thinking she's down with, come on, man. Because she's some hot sauce. Y'all think she's down. Y'all need to stop being a fool. This is the smoke and mirrors for you. The country is in, listen, y'all. I just want to tell you, the country, we on the Titanic. We hit the iceberg. There's no recovery. We are $70 trillion in debt. There's no recovery. There's no. Now, what you should be thinking about, like, if I was on the Titanic, my thought would be, now, you got people who will sit there and tell you, just listen to the band play. You remember the band kept playing while the ship was going down? And they tell you to sit there and listen to the band play. Now y'all know we black. You ain't got to tell. If I know that's why the movie didn't have no black people. They was in the bottom of the boat. They locked them brothers in the bottom of the boat because you ain't got to tell me. I'm going to take me one whole boat, lifeboat, by myself. That's my mindset. So if we had an iceberg, I ain't patching the boat. I ain't trying to play the music to make you feel comfortable. I ain't trying to even feel make you. I hope you scared. I'm getting off the ship. I feel prophetic coming. I'm trying to stay out of it. I feel it coming. What y'all don't know is going on is black people gonna realize you're gonna have to get off this ship. The boat is going down. Now you getting that? See, the problem is, why would you go down on the boat that had you on the bottom rowing? You never experienced the upper deck where you were sitting there eating the good food. You was the servant on the boat. So get off the boat. Now to get off the boat, let me tell y'all how down there y'all saying amen, but y'all ain't gonna do nothing because I know black folk. I know how y'all think. To get off the boat, you have to leave her. This is what y'all don't get. It's gonna get that bad. Do you have a passport? You gotta think international. I know y'all don't think that way because you know, that's the slavery mentality. You know, well, this is what my mama was, and this is what my daddy was, and this is what my grandmama was. And everybody, we live in five blocks, and everybody go to the same church, everybody run together, everybody birthday together, everybody run. You know, so that's what makes y'all not achieve in life. You have to realize that the majority of the folk in your life will not go where you're going. They will not go. They won't see what you see. Me and my wife been all over the world because we never care about people not going or going with us or not going. We just go. That's how you break fear. Anyway, let me keep going. Now, I'm saying this to say, I was talking about reaping and sowing, wasn't I? Let me get there. Now, go over here. Now I'm going to go over here to Galatians. Oh, it's all good. Galatians chapter 6. I want to break your fear. Break your fear. You have to understand that how is it we supposed to have been free for 150 years and many of us have not even went to another state. Freedom means mobility, the ability to move. That's what freedom is. Prison is stuck. We are free to have mobility. One of the reasons why, you have to realize how I told you before how difficult it was to, Stisha was our firstborn, loved her with all our heart. She was 23, when we was talking about her leaving. And of course, as much as we love her, and it was very difficult because that was something that we had not saw done. We have no reference, you know. And but because we had already traveled the world, me and my wife, we knew about how easy it was to do it. But we were very afraid because she's a female, you know. I went against my principle and watched the movie Taken. That movie puts up in me, boy. I tell you, I shouldn't have watched it. I'm telling y'all the principle. I watched it as first thing I thought. Silly girl, get off the airplane, and here she is. Somebody talked into her, got in the cab, she's gone. Now I got to ride. I got a special set of skills. I probably would do it. I know, man. My mind's like it. I probably would do that. I'd be down in somebody's country, like, man, I can give me a gun. How can I get? So I was thinking that way. But because I understood that we're curse breaking. Amen. Curse breaking. Meaning she will not fall into the trap that we fell into. That's good. That's good. And not achieve and not see anything but what the last generation saw. Amen. And so I had to break my own fear. Because you know how the devil paint that picture. Oh, she'll get down there and she get messed up. What if I'm out? Oh, somebody might meet the wrong person. Oh, she might, somebody give her some drugs. You know, I had to break all of that. Amen. And trust God. Amen. That what I put in her, amen, she would walk in it. Amen. And I'll never forget the day that we released her. And I was, y'all got to know me. I'm a papa bear. Everything in me, I was trying to talk her out of it. I was trying to say no, because it was just my heart. I didn't want to let her go. But then I realized it was my fear. And I remember that day we let her go, and she's doing, of course, now she's doing wonderful. But the point is, she would not live her dream if I projected my fear, if I let her live in my fear. You understand what I'm saying? This is the curse on us, is that we project our fear onto our children because we couldn't do something, we fearfully stop them from doing it. Or we don't encourage them that they can do it. The whole point is, my knots and scars are a roadmap for my children to read. See, they look at my knots and scars and see the pitfalls and don't do this and don't do that and what not to do. And if I sow the right thing into them, then my knots and my scars and my mistakes should catapult them. Amen. further than I can go. Because what I fell in, they'll jump over based upon the map that they see. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So my goal as a parent is to keep them from sowing the wrong thing when they're young so they don't have to reap it when they're older. Amen. Y'all there? Look at this. 1 Galatians 6. Real quick. Are you there? I want y'all to get there. Everybody get there. I want you to see this. Do not be deceived. Say, don't be deceived.
Don't be deceived.
No, let's not run over that. I know we got to hurry, but don't run over that. That means don't think that you're going to do something different or this is not going to work against you like it will work against everybody else. Don't think you're going to do something and come up with a different answer. Don't be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. My job as a parent is to keep these silly kids that are silly. The Bible says foolishness is in the heart of every child. My goal is to keep them from sowing something foolish. So they don't have to reap. Because they gonna reap. And listen, if they sow bad things, how do you overcome bad things? How do you overcome bad things? You sow good things. So when they go, if you see bad, you got to immediately begin to sow good. Because my goal is to try to keep them, even you yourself. That's what your problem is. You keep sowing bad, think you're going to get good. You know, that's what they say the definition of insanity is. Keep doing the same thing and plan on getting something different. If you keep sowing the wrong thing, you're going to get the wrong thing. Are you there? Look at verse 8. For he that soweth to his flesh shall reap the corruption shall of the flesh. I mean, he soweth to his flesh of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the spirit shall reap everlasting life. So there's two ways for me to sow. Are you ready? Now you going to sow. Sow means to put a seed in the ground. It means to plant. Come on, that's basic. Say plant. You going to sow. There's only two ways to sow. Only two things you can sow in. And you gotta choose early in life what you're going to sow to. You're going to either sow to your flesh, which means please yourself. Or you're going to sow into spiritual things, which means delayed gratification. Jesus said, if any man would follow after me, let him deny himself. A true disciple is a denier of self. So that means that if I'm really going to follow Christ, I got to learn to deny myself. So that means I cannot please myself. I can't sow into my flesh. I have to sow into spirit. So spiritual things are stuff like patience, humility, long-suffering, gentleness, integrity. These are things that are spiritual concepts that cause spiritual, good spiritual harvest. Are you there? But if I sow to my flesh, the Bible says I start reaping corruption to the flesh. So that means sowing to the flesh is basically giving in to every impulse. I feel high. I feel like getting high. Well, I'm going to go get high. I'm going to cuss them out. I'll do it. See, whatever I feel, I do. Because I want to gratify the flesh. See, the flesh is what's gratified when you cut somebody out. When you give somebody a piece of your mind, you know what feel good? The flesh feel good. It feel good to say something wrong to somebody. It feel good. Sometimes it just feels good to let that go. But then you reap the corruption after you do that. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So when you sow to the flesh, like anger, the Bible says be angry, but sin not. But when anger goes over into sin, I start reaping the corruption from the sin that I'm participating in. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Say lust. That's a good one. When you give in to lust, when you start giving in to pornography, masturbation, fornication, your flesh is the one that pays the price. Now, you don't believe it, but some of us are older. We know our flesh is paying the price for stuff we did. Your flesh will break down on you. That's the price for sexual sin when you're younger. It feel good when you're younger, but as you get older, you'll find out certain things be slowing down on you. Your knees start messing up. You start having all these problems. You don't know what's going on. Female problems and growths and fibroids and stuff. Y'all don't want to talk about this. Where's that coming from? That comes from sowing to your flesh early. See, the best thing you can do is teach your child that your innocence and purity is beautiful. Now, we ain't celebrating. Can I keep it? I'm y'all know me anyway. I'm going to keep 100. We don't celebrate baby showers. We don't wear mothers. We love the baby. Thank you that the baby here. Glad God bless the baby. But I ain't going to celebrate it because I don't want my daughter to sit there and think this is what we celebrating. Because if she sees it celebrated, she's going to think this is how you get celebrated. What we should be celebrating is the girl over here went to school, didn't do that, didn't get in no trouble, didn't. That's what you celebrate. Now, when you celebrate her, you sow into the spirit. But you giving this girl an award for doing something everybody can do. You tell me how this is a special thing. Getting pregnant ain't special. It's normal. It's natural. But we celebrate it, and these young girls be sitting there in the baby shower looking at it, and this is what they think celebration is. Now, what we don't celebrate, then get married and see how many people celebrate that. Get engaged, talk about marriage, and watch how many people talk about it. Now, well, are you sure? Girl, I don't know. Y'all might need to live together for a while. See, celebrate. They'll celebrate some sin. We reap what we sow. See, we don't celebrate that. Don't mean we don't love folk. Don't mean we don't care about folk. It just mean I ain't gonna give you no award for messing up your life. That is a curse. We did it. It's a curse. It's a curse. The Bible said the sins of the parents passed down to the children. Oh, y'all don't want this. You can, when you go to the doctor, the first thing the doctor asks you, who got it in the family? They know that stuff comes through your bloodline. Who got diabetes? Who got high blood pressure? Oh, my mama got it. My grandmama had it. Everybody. They know it come through the blood. Now, if we can understand that physical come through the bloodline, why don't spiritual? Even though we can see. She had a baby 14. She had a baby 14. Grandma had a baby 14. Daughter had a baby 14. Her daughter had a baby 14. Right. Amen. She ain't wed. She didn't get married. She didn't get married. They didn't get married. None of the aunties married. None of the sisters married. Nobody's married. Right. He went to prison. He went to prison. He went to prison. Daddy went to prison. Mom went to prison. Cousin went to prison. Daddy went to prison. Amen. He got killed. He got killed. Son got killed. It's a curse. Amen. That means there is sin that is not atoned for in the family, and Satan has a license to keep coming to the next generation until somebody break the curse. You want to know why he's acting like that? His daddy acted like that. His daddy smoked weed, he gonna smoke weed. His daddy sold drugs, he gonna sell drugs. It's a matter of time before the spirit that was on his father worm his way to him. The sins of the parents passed down to the children. You can't escape what you sow. Oh, y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying. See, when you understand spiritual laws and principles, you begin to understand why you don't live a certain way. Why I don't do this? I ain't trying to be better. I think I'm better than nobody. I understand that if I sow this, my children will reap it. Let me go a step further. Y'all want this now. I know y'all want. You're squirming on this type of message. This is a responsibility. I mean, kids ain't just coming here bad. Now, you ever seen that parent sit there and say, "They, I don't know why they like it." You why they like it? What do you mean you don't know you? How you going to divorce yourself from this? Ain't that true? Now you go, I'm gonna tell you, you go right over here, you go to get around a bunch of older people and watch how they talk about it. I don't know what the girl done. She just acting, I don't know what's going on. Now you know you was a whore too. She learned whoring from you. I don't know why she like it, because now you okay now. You done come through your whore years. I said it. You done come through your whore years. That means is you too old to drop it. It don't drop. When it do, you drop it, stay. Can't drop it no more. You got to lay it down. Can't drop it. It don't drop, so I got to lay it down now. I guess you don't whore no more. You can't drop it no more. You got to lay it down. And so them same people would sit there and talk like, "Oh, girl, I don't know why she like it. I don't know what she acting like." And you be now, if some of y'all was smart, you'd be like, "Wait a minute, wasn't you? You do know you the one gave me weed first. You introduced me to the boyfriend first. Do you not? They forget. People, old folk forget on you. Oh, they forget they were wicked. They forget they was drunks and piss heads and domestic violence and fighting. They forget all that. It's that they get older. Like, you get over 50, you ain't in amnesia. I don't know. Like, they always been in church with the cocked hat. They always been in church. That's why they don't really want you to know who they come up with. They don't ever want you to know their friend, because they know if you their real friends, you know your mama. They'll tell on you. You know your mama. That's why we tell all our kids what we did. I want them to know. You ain't going to get around nobody and say, you know, everything you're going to say about me, they know. We ain't had no, we tell them. See, when you tell your children what you used to be, it shows them the redemptive power of God. I mean, God, even through all that, God was able to save me. So if you go out there and get in trouble, he can save you. Don't go that way, but if you do, he's good. What was I saying? Reap. This is something that is very, a concept that's very difficult now, that we don't get the point that we actually are seeing in our generation. So let me try. If I go back, the 70s is when the drug scene really came in. And we got high, forgot civil rights, got high. Heroin came in, you know, we got high. Disco 54, I mean, 64, 54, whatever it was, gay stuff, all this stuff came in. And we dropped our revolutionary stuff, afros for perms, and we just went on into the... Now, that generation, is where the abortion came in during that generation, and the out of wedlock births came in that generation, and that was a real bad scene. But then the next generation, so if you go into the 80s, then that generation took it further. See, then all of a sudden the introduction of hip hop came out. Now you had a soundtrack to your anger. That's all hip-hop was. Hip-hop's a soundtrack to fatherless boys. Hip-hop will father your child if you let it. It gives fatherless boys an identity that their father didn't give them. It's fatherless boys talking to fatherless boys. That's why you can't let your child be raised up on a diet of hip-hop, because it will give them the philosophy that a father was supposed to give them. Most of what these boys know, they know from hip hop. They don't know by no man teaching them. Hip hop told them how to treat a woman. Hip hop told them what a girl was. Hip hop, the video showed them what a woman is. The video showed them how to get money. Hip hop told them that they don't know anything about, they don't have no mentoring other than the music. And if they didn't have a father to see, the reason why our sons, we have a big drug culture is because the music told us. That's where I got it at. My father wasn't in my life the minute I heard dope man. Oh, that was it. That was what I was looking for. See, the music became the mentor. I'm gonna say that again. The music became the mentor. So when your child is in the room and they zoned out, what do you think they get? They are downloading their future. You want to see your child's future? Look on the iPhone. Look on the iPod. Whatever they listening to, that's their future. Don't matter what I say at church, don't matter what they come to church and hear. When they leave here, what's in that iPhone is going to be what they do. Remember I said, as a man thinking in his heart, so Satan just uses the music to give them the image of thugging out and just sexing and drugging and all of that. And then you wonder why they won't take pills and they want to take drugs to turn them into zombies, and you don't know why. What? Because they sing songs about Molly and it looks cool, and they take it. So they're gonna do, because they get mentored by these fatherless boys. And the only way to combat that, I told y'all before, you got to cut that stuff off and replace it with something else. You got to have some type of something else to get in between her. But because we are so set, you know, if we've been doing it so many years, it's like this becomes our mentorship, and they will fight you over this. One of the only times that I've been saved, that I was really getting ready to fight somebody. And I'm talking about, I was saved. Only one, really one time was when I said something about Tupac. And this young boy, he swelled up, got to crying, and oh no, Tupac. Because I said, if Tupac didn't know Christ, Tupac's in hell. Man, you can't say that. Man, Tupac was a soldier. And man, he was really ready to fight me. I would have whooped him anyway. I was going to fight him. I wasn't going to let him hit me in my mouth or nothing because I'm like, you ain't going to tell me I'm wrong. I'm right. I know I'm right. So if he didn't get his life right with Jesus Christ, I don't care how good he rapped. Be rapping down there in hell. Man, that brother swole up. He started crying. He was like, the spirit came on him. That's when I seen it. That's when I seen this is a demonic spirit. Because it's like a something came on this brother. And before this boy said something, we was just as cool talking. But the minute I said that, it's like something came over him. Like, oh. Now you think like, man, I might have to really get with this boy. You know, I might have to really, you know, go back to my, let me wait, man. I might have to really... Because he was serious. He was jumping around. It was another guy there that was kind of the one that stopped the madness. But he was really upset because I wasn't going to back off what I said. I'm like, you ain't going to make me change what I said. I said, if. Right. I don't know if he did. I said, if. Amen. Brother started crying. Why? And then that's when I realized, I said, this is demonic. I said that this guy don't know Tupac at all. Don't have no relationship with him. But yet he's talking about him. This is what the Bible says an idol is. That's why we are not supposed to worship idols. Because when we worship idols, we give our idols a pass. We give our idols a pass. We will overlook the stuff our idols do because we like they giving us something. They giving us something. We see, when Prince died, I tell y'all what I remember. There was a skit I saw on YouTube when it was something about Dave Chappelle was talking about. Michael Jackson being on trial. And Dave said, they was telling Dave, Dave, he did this and he did this. And Dave said, man, he made Thriller. Like, he couldn't possibly be wrong because look at what he gave us. That's what an idol does. Because that idol makes you feel good, you will not go against that idol. Even though they could be doing some, most of y'all entertainers live a contradictory life. One minute they talking about how good God is, the next minute they dropping it, cussing, and y'all just straight right there. You don't seem to, but let me do it. Amen. Now y'all hold a Christian to the fire. Amen. But Beyonce, let Jesus say yes. She can do that. Then she go over and surfboard and y'all, oh hey, wasn't that good? Y'all don't have no problem with it. But let my wife come in here and then she surfboard. Oh, did you see her surfboard? You know why? Because she's not your idol. But that's your idol. So your idol can't do no wrong. That's why Satan makes people famous. So you'll worship them and then you'll receive every bad thing they do. And then you'll model their behavior and you'll be going to hell with your idol. That's what fame is. That's why the Bible talks about it. I got clothes. Y'all ain't ready for this. That's why the Bible says in Matthew, when Jesus was tempted, Satan came and said, listen, I tell you what, I will give you the world. I will, if you bow down and worship me, I'll give you fame. See, that's what he offers. So all he does is your little idols and your little stars, all of them take the deal. The ones that take the deal, famous, the ones that not, don't. If you don't believe me, if you've ever watched American Idol, look how many talented ones it really is. And then the ones that actually make it ain't always talent. The ones that now they ain't talented, none of these people that are really talented, they just made a deal, a spiritual deal. It's a spiritual deal. You can make it if you want it. You can be broke and make it if you want to make it. Satan don't mind giving you something. You think Satan care about fame and money? Give you money to buy your influence. He's buying your influence over other people. Talk to me. And so this is the reason why he uses the entertainment industry. And most of us are being led by the entertainment industry. And when somebody talks about your favorite entertainer, they're always hating. They hating on him. I remember Lil Wayne got up and said, what was the song? The song might have been the Millie or something. I don't really know about it, but I heard about it. But I saw when he got up on the award show, so I want to thank God. You know, this is what bothers me, how we accept that. Like, wait a minute, what? So God is giving these lyrics? You mean God is saying this stuff? God is telling y'all to do this? See, and because we don't correct it, our young people don't know that God don't work like that. God ain't giving you no murderous stuff. God ain't telling you to murder no, but God ain't saying that stuff. You channeling that from a demon. I ain't going to go into that. But that's where it comes from. Y'all there or not there? Y'all don't want this now. What I say, Galatians? I'm going to be done. Yeah. All right. Now, verse 9. I was in Galatians 6. Galatians 6. Let me read verse 8. For he that soweth to the flesh shall reap the corruption of the flesh. Now, this is an easy scripture. Sow to your flesh means give your flesh what it want. Give your flesh what it want, right? So if your flesh want to smoke weed, you're going to reap the corruption of lung cancer. If your flesh wants sex, you're going to reap the corruption of STDs. You're going to reap the corruption. If you give into your flesh, you're going to reap it. You understand what I'm saying? That means that the price you pay for giving into your flesh is the breakdown of your body. The price you pay is the breakdown of your body. That's what you lose. You sow to the flesh, you reap the corruption. The Bible says, what profit the man to gain the whole world but lose his soul? Your soul, the Bible says, is your mind, your will, and emotions. What profit you to gain everything? That means if I gain everything in the world, I lose my mind. I lose my will. I lose my ability to say yes and no. This is what the price of sin is. When you give in to your flesh or give in to sin, you lose control of yourself. See, sin always seems good in the beginning, but after you get into it, after it's a hook in it, that you don't see that hook till later, then you realize I'm out of control. One of the worst feelings is to be out of control. It's to say, I'm not going to do something, and then you do it anyway. Oh, you know how it feels to be trying to serve God? That's a bad feeling, to be wanting to serve the Lord, and then you fail. And you say, I ain't going to do it, but then there's this insatiable force that seems to be driving you. You know, you have the feeling so strong, and then after you give into your flesh, it's quiet, and you left with your shame. You left with your own. Now these same thoughts are condemning you. The same voice that was motivating to do it is now condemning you. This is how Satan works. This is what temptation is. Do it, do it, do it, do it. He torments you to do it. Can I go deep? I'm gonna go deep in there. I'm gonna go deep. Look, let me go deeper. Spirits must be fed. Whatever spirit motivates you, it's gotta be fed. It's like hunger, and the way they get fed is through sin. So a spirit of lust, you must feed it lust. So a spirit of lust will motivate you to lust. Look at pornography. Go do it. Do it. Masturbate. Once you give in to it, the spirit is fed, and then there's a calm. Y'all know what I'm talking about. It's a calm after that. You left with your own thoughts. Then that's when this shame come on you. Condemnation comes on you. Godly sorrow come on you. And then you get angry at yourself, and I hate that I'm in this position. You come to church or you pray and you feel a little, you get to feeling better, and then out of the blue, that same thought come back, and you right back down that road again. And it keeps happening in a cycle, because Satan is hoping you don't know that it's not just you. It's something spiritual. Because you have opened up yourself to sin, now something else is trying to possess your soul. That means something else is in control. Because the Bible says a man's will, that means my ability to say yes and no is always with me. That means I should have the ability to stop anything in my life. If I can't stop it, something else is in control. Something else is stronger than me. So if I tell myself, I will not drink this, and I'm just feel myself just got to go do it, something else is in control. Now I'm into what the Bible talks about, possession. Something else is possessing some part of me. And now it's no longer a thing of mind over matter. Something need to be cast out. Y'all ain't ready for me. See, this is what the church is missing. See, the church wants to preach the demons instead of saying, no, you just need to get delivered. You need a spirit cast out. I've been to church for years. Brothers beating on their wives and talking about that brother. No, he don't need, no, he doesn't need a devil cast out of him. Brothers is up in the middle of the night going and visiting prostitutes. No, brother, you need the spirit of lust cast out of you. The Bible says we wrestle not against flesh and blood. It ain't natural. It's spiritual. What Satan will make you do is justify or rationalize or reason why you can have this in your life. Instead of you seeing it as bondage, you will see it as just a little problem. It's just a little something I do. But no, you're bound. You are hooked. It's just like a fish on the hook. You can't get off. When that happens, you need something, somebody stronger than you. That's where Christ comes. That's where the anointing, the power of God must come in at that point to set you or to separate you from something that has a grip on. This is something that I really want y'all to understand. I've been saved for about 20 years now. Been living for God for about 20 years. When I first came to the Lord, when I was in the streets, I had no problem. I thought I had no problem with lust. I'm serious. I mean, it wasn't no thing because, I mean, in the streets, you could just do it. I had no conscience. I mean, it wasn't nothing to do wrong, and you didn't even think about doing wrong. It was like, but when I got saved and my conscience became tender, I began to feel this strong pull when I denied myself. When I said I wasn't going to do it, that's when it's like fire. And that's when I began to understand that I was bound. I was bound. And some of y'all don't know that what you think is just a problem is really a spiritual bondage. You are bound. You cannot look at things as, well, I just need to pray a little more. No, it's a spiritual bondage. You have given in to your flesh. When the Bible says don't do this and don't do that, it ain't saying don't do it just to keep you from having a good time. It means if you open the spiritual doors. And if you open these spiritual doors, spirits come in. Sin is the door that opens you up to demonic forces. You know, I remember years ago, I was listening to an interview by Bone Thugs and Harmony years ago, and I remember they was talking about that when they would get the, you know, if you ever listened to that years ago, that music was on a whole nother, them brothers was spiritual in some other place. It was totally demonic what they was into. Then I found out that one little light-skinned boy was actually in the occult. But they would say, they would go in the studio and just smoke weed and just get so high. And all of a sudden, they said stuff would come in the studio and give them these lyrics. It would just come in them. You know how Jay-Z said, you just open up the door. See, they channeling spirits. But Satan got to have a trigger. The trigger is sin. The Bible says, be not ignorant of Satan's device. Meaning you touch Satan's stuff, you give him a license. So this is what drugs do. This is what illicit sex or fornication is doing. It's opening up people to be possessed. Then after you come down out of your stupor or your high, you'll find that you have an urge that you didn't have before. You have a strong urge that it wasn't there before. I'll tell you how another way. Sometimes spirits can transfer from another person. Now you was okay. Now some people, you have sex with that person and all of a sudden you are totally different after them. And you'll be like, man, I wasn't even into this stuff. Now I'm just got these thoughts. Where they come from? Transfer spirits from them. Amen. Sin is the gateway. So that's why the Bible teaches, when the Bible says, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this, it's saying this is how you keep the door closed so Satan don't have an entrance in your life. But if you go ahead and willfully disobey God, then you open up a spiritual door that spirits will come in and live in your life. So this is why Satan created a culture of sin. Of everything got to be just sin, 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 sex, 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 sex. And this is why you see people doing crazy crimes and weird stuff and having sex with babies and all this pedophilia going on. Now, what is it coming from? It's coming because people have opened themselves up through these to these spirits through disobedience to God. And so that's why you have to begin to pray. Lord, shut the doors that I have opened up. Now, you know what doors you got, place on. You know what doors you got. Because the doors of sin in your life are what continues you fall in it all the time. You say, I ain't going to do it, but you be right back there. You get over it for a week, 2 weeks, a month, and you right back there. The doors of sin are opening your life. And if you don't break that, it'll be a cycle that eventually you'll get tired of repenting, you'll get tired of guilt, and you'll justify and say, you know what? This is just the way it is. This is what's gonna have to be in my life. And you'll think that God is okay with that, and your soul will be in a balance. The whole reason for preaching is to bring people to repentance, meaning I know I'm not right with God. Why would I come to church and hear a good message on, why would I come to hear I'm so great? That shouldn't be what I'm hearing. I should be coming to church to be convicted of where I am not good. What is wrong in my life? The Holy Spirit ain't all this just a bunch of dancing and huckabucking. The Bible said the Spirit of God convicts men of sin. So when you sense the Spirit of God, you should feel convicted. Conviction is a godly sorrow. A godly sorrow will make you feel like, I need to get this right with God. That's what preachers should do. Stand on your feet.